The Pleiadian Mission, A Time of Awareness. Part 13. Learning Meditation. I was raised in the Episcopal Church in the Midwestern town of Wichita, Kansas, and was considered a Christian, just like everyone else there. It wasn't until I began to travel the world many years after leaving home that I became aware of the many different belief structures and concepts of life that exist on Earth. The concept of meditation was one new idea that I learned to embrace. It has taken on a growing importance in my life. I had meditated before, but what I was learning from Billy was all new to me and took some real brain work for me to understand. The concepts of meditation/concentration prove useful in developing personal control and, most importantly, are a means to access the spiritual power in all of us. I had never been exposed to meditation when I was younger. I was only taught prayer at the church. A whole new world opened up to me when I discovered what can be learned and accomplished through meditation. At the center, Billy has built a meditation room that all of the members of the FIGU use. They have a regular schedule, which they keep on the kitchen wall, so that they can keep track of the time spent in the meditation room each week. Since all of the members were learning and studying spiritual growth themselves, the meditation room was a very busy place. What is meditation? Meditation is mostly associated with Eastern philosophy, since it is practiced so widely there. But it should be made clear that meditation is a form of concentration which leads to control of the mind, and it can be practiced by anyone. It is not necessary to adhere to any mystical philosophy, belief system, or religion to use meditation for your own benefit. Even though its popularity lies in the East, it is rapidly gaining in use in Western society. Increasingly, more people discover the benefits of being able to communicate with the many different levels of consciousness through meditation. It is a method by which we can gain control over our thought processes, develop spiritually, or come in communication with higher life forms such as the Pleiadians. When we come into a new life, our material consciousness is formed along with our body. Our senses of sight, touch, smell, taste, and hearing are developed for information gathering, and we begin to form new thoughts. At this point, our new material subconscious only has the memories of birth, and our psyche is almost devoid of any feelings, emotions, and attitudes. Material emotions and memories are created and collected during the life; they do not exist when we arrive. All that comes with us are the memories and feelings of the spirit. Our thought processes are very simple, for we have no material memories or psychic feelings to create them. It is here that we have the opportunity to learn to think properly so that our life can be lived and experienced to its greatest joy. Most of the worries of the world are caused by illogical thinking. At the time the spirit enters the body and the new life begins, we are healthy in body and spirit. The spirit cannot be illogical or sick; this is strictly a function of the material self. As the body is being formed, its potential can be degenerated during the pregnancy by drugs, alcohol, mental illness, and illogical thinking on the part of the mother. The new material life will already be damaged and cannot live to the fullest ability of the accumulated knowledge gained by the spirit. This can limit intelligence and aptitude and cause birth defects, which will impair the ability to think correctly. If the mother would use meditation during the pregnancy, she could not only communicate with the incoming person, but could control her own thinking and provide for a healthier birth. By controlling our thinking, we control both our physical and mental health, thus providing a good beginning for the new life. By learning meditation, you develop what is called the meditation concentration. This is nothing more than developing the ability to concentrate on a particular object and see it clearly, untainted by feelings, attitudes, memories, and negative and positive thinking, while not allowing any other thoughts to enter your mind. Once this is accomplished, you are in control of your thinking and on the road to developing powerful spiritual abilities as well. There are many ways that meditation can be helpful in your life. The conscious thinking. Most of our entire life is spent in conscious thinking. It is the process of forming a thought from our memories and feelings, which allows us to communicate with ourselves and each other. If we could not think, we could not learn or grow, and would be no different from the animals with which we share the earth. Thought allows us to understand our experiences and gain in wisdom, which leads to spiritual growth. Without thought, we could not function as living beings. Even though thought is so important to us, there is very little training on how to perform it. In school we are told what to think, but not how to do it. There is no education on how to think or how to control the thinking processes. Through meditation we will learn to not only understand what thought is, but how to control it for our benefit. First, there is the conscious mind. Its energy affects the electrical body which charges the chemicals that feed the cells. Negative and positive thinking. As we create the energy of thought, we give these energies a negative, positive, or neutral charge due to our own way of thinking, feeling, and according to our own behavior patterns. Meditation can serve as a means for achieving harmony between the positive and negative and create a state of balance, or neutral thinking. You will also learn to know yourself better and exercise more control over yourself. The spiritual powers. Through meditation/concentration you can learn to bring forth the spiritual powers of telepathy, telekinesis, and time travel. These abilities are inherent in the spirit and can be made accessible to the material self through meditation, if you are willing to put in the time and effort. Telepathy is the ability for humans to send and receive thoughts using the we form sense that is in all of us. The material self and the spiritual self both have dissimilar we forms which operate differently. Both can be accessed through meditation and can be developed to be useful attributes in our life. You can also learn telekinesis, a method of moving objects without touching them physically, again through the use of pure spiritual powers. For most people this ability may take years of practice in order to develop the necessary concentration. If practiced every day, the average person may find some success in about 7 years. Meditation can enable you to transfer yourself mentally/visually into the past or future and gain information on various events. These events may be in the past or may be projections of a future that has not yet happened. The ability to develop and use any of your natural spiritual powers lies in the development of meditation as the tool or mechanism by which you gain access to these abilities. All communications of the mind and spirit are made possible through meditation. You will find it necessary to put in a great deal of time and energy into this practice of meditation/concentration, in the material realm as well as in the spiritual realm, if you expect to achieve any kind of results. The concentration. Meditation allows you to see something clearly, observe it clearly and recognize it clearly, without entertaining a thought. First we produce the desire or will to create a meditative concentration, to grasp something or to put something into practice. Then the desire or will must be completely disregarded and put aside so that the concentration can be obtained. This means that in order to obtain a pure, meditative concentration, a reflection in the purest form, a clarity of vision of whatever it happens to be, the will must not be carried into the meditation. When you are ready to meditate, you do not say, "Now, I will concentrate," or "Now, I will meditate," or "Now, I will do this or that." These are the thoughts that form your will to perform meditation and must be set aside, or you will not be able to concentrate in any form. By developing meditation, we learn to direct our senses towards something quite definite, and then we concentrate on it. During this concentration, no other thoughts may be entertained because the concentration may consist only of absolute clarity of vision, or clarity of reflection. This means we must observe the object of our concentration while being completely void of any outside thoughts. Meditation, then, is going to allow us to control our day-to-day thinking and give us access to the powers of our higher spiritual self. Consequently, meditation means this: learning balance, learning clarity of vision and clarity of reflection, acquiring the ability to transmit spiritual consciousness into the spheres of the past and the future, and acquisition of spiritual capabilities such as telepathy, telekinesis, etc. Next, let's discuss the need for meditation, and then, how to perform meditation and what it can do for us. The need for meditation. When we first come into life, our thoughts are very simple. Our conscious mind is functioning well, and all of our senses are working and are trying to interpret the new world we are in. We can see around us, but don't know what we are looking at. We can hear sounds, but have no idea what they are. Touching things is a new discovery, and even the food we eat doesn't seem familiar. The reason everything is so new and unfamiliar is that the material subconscious has very little information in it. We have very few memories yet, and at this point we have no data in our subconscious to flash us those sympathy or antipathy feelings that are used to form thoughts. Remember, our conscious mind creates thoughts by flashing to the subconscious, checking for any available data that we have on the object of which we are forming the thought. Since the subconscious is where we keep our memories and has nothing to flash back yet, our thoughts are very simple indeed. The subconscious deals in visions, not words, and portrays its message in dreams. As we continue to experience the world around us, we begin to build up memories in our subconscious from experience. These are new memories about our mother, our crib, the food we are fed, and the many new sounds we hear. Very slowly we begin to create feelings of happiness as we are fed and taken care of. And, of course, there is the love we feel for our parents. These feelings start to form the emotions that build up in our psyche, which will also become part of our new thoughts. The process of thinking is instinctive, so we don't have to figure it out. The flashing between our conscious and our subconscious is built in and is ready to operate. It only needs data to start building more complex thoughts. As we get older and continue to experience the world around us, our thoughts will increase in complexity. We came into the world happy and full of love, but as we get older and come in contact with a more hostile and unfriendly world, we start to form new emotions to protect ourselves. If we let this process go unchecked, eventually we fill our psyche with feelings of anxiety, fear, hostility, anger, and depression in order to respond to this new environment. These psychic feelings then become part of our thoughts and how we express ourselves. No one comes into the world angry or prejudiced and yelling at those around them. These are acquired responses as a result of life's experiences. Through meditation, we can learn to control incoming data so that when our psyche is forming, we can handle the fear, anger, and hostility that are directed towards us, so negative emotions do not form. As we are confronted with negative elements in society, we can learn to pause during the flashing process that forms our thoughts and use our spiritual self to keep in balance. When we are young, most of us are overwhelmed with childhood experiences that leave very deep emotional scars which affect our thinking as we get older. As we reach maturity, we recognize that we are not in control of our thoughts and go searching for ways to rid ourselves of depression, anger, anxiety, and other negative feelings that rule our lives. We turn to self-help courses of different types, which make an effort to help us overcome our inner feelings and live a more balanced life. It would have been better if we had been taught how to think, using meditation when we were young, then, we would not have formed these negative feelings in the first place. Meditation provides us with the inner strength to deal with any situation and remain in a calm and balanced state. Since meditation gives us access to communication between the any areas of the mind, it should be taught to everyone when they are young. After all, thinking controls our life, so why not learn to do it better? If we have already reached adulthood, we can still learn to meditate and repair the damage that has been done. Once we learn to control our thinking and bring our spiritual selves into action, our lives become easier and more productive. How to perform a simple meditation? Before getting any more detailed about what is possible through meditation, let's go through the steps of a simple meditation/concentration so that we better understand the process and see what is possible. There are many methods of inducing meditation, ranging from focusing on a candle flame or concentrating on a crystal. You may use any method that suits you, but I prefer to develop the meditative/concentration using breathing, since our respiration connects us directly to our life energy and gives us a sense of well-being. For best results, this should be done in a sitting position, preferably in the lotus position with legs crossed. This type of sitting position should not be seen as the only method, especially in the Western world, as the lotus position can be very difficult due to lack of practice. You must use a position that is comfortable so that your attention is not drawn to any bodily discomfort, which will distract you during the meditation. For myself, I use a soft cushion to sit on, since my legs do not fold very well. You do not want to be influenced by outside energies or sound, so try to find a location that is both comfortable and quiet. If you have room in your home, you may want to build a special meditation area where you are comfortable and not bothered by the outside world. Here you can cleanse your surroundings of negative energies and create an environment where you feel comfortable and relaxed. It is also important that you free yourself of all worldly objects like watches, rings, necklaces, earrings, or any other jewelry you may normally wear that affects your personality or thoughts. It is also suggested that no clothing whatsoever be worn, but that, of course, is up to you. The objective here is to put you in the most balanced state possible, so you can bring out the spiritual being that is connected to creation, and leave the material being and all of its feelings, emotions, and personality behind during the concentration. The relaxation. Once we are in a comfortable position, we are ready to relax ourselves. The thinking of the day stores its energy in all of the cells of our body. So we are more affected than others. We can release this buildup of tension by taking 3 deep breaths and releasing them slowly. Deep breathing is very good at releasing energy and bringing the body back to a more relaxed state. The breathing exercise. The breathing exercise is used to familiarize us with the concept of concentration, so we can learn to control our thinking. The objective here is to observe the natural flow of our respiration, while not influencing it in any way. Do not hold your breath or intentionally subject it to any artificial rhythm. The object here is to follow the breathing procedure calmly and carefully during the exercise. Close your eyes and focus your attention on the sides of your nostrils, and begin to observe your breath as it moves in and out of your nasal passage. Try to keep in a state of observation and do not become involved in the rhythm of your breath. If you catch yourself affecting the flow of your breath, causing it to speed up or slow down, just relax and become the observer, not the controller. You will probably make an effort to control your breath and may cause it to go even more out of control. Simply relax and let your breath find its own pace, and remember, you have been breathing for years without any help from your conscious mind. Simply become the observer and make no attempt to regulate the flow of your breath. Observation means that you are not influencing the breath in any way with any of your material senses or thoughts, you are only observing it. Observe your breath as it flows up the side of your nostrils and disappears at the top of your nose. Do not follow it. This would take your attention away from your observation spot. The inhaling and exhaling usually becomes noticeable as a cool stream of air that keeps moving. Even if your observation is strictly concentrate on the fixed point at the sides of the nose, nostrils, a peripheral awareness of the course of the breath through the body is produced, arising from the slight pressure of the air we breathe. No further consideration should be given to it. As your concentration continues, you will begin to notice exactly what air the breath enters the nostrils, where it starts to flow up the sides of the nostrils, and where it disappears. These 3 spots mark the beginning, middle, and end of the breath, and they become clearer and clearer as the concentration continues. Awareness of your body. If you become very uncomfortable during this exercise, you will not be able to continue and may have to start over. However, if you only become aware of your body, you should simply treat this awareness as an observation which has disturbed the tranquil harmony of the concentration. Simply visualize that the respiration exists, completely independent of the intention of the meditation exercise, and discard the awareness of your body. Unwanted thoughts. As you continue to observe your breath, it is only natural that unwanted thoughts come into your mind. Since we are not trained in controlling our thinking, our mind is used to racing from one thought to another anytime it wishes. By developing concentration, the ability to focus on only one object at a time, we are serving notice to our material consciousness that we are taking charge of our thinking. This will be something new for most of us, and it will require some time to become successful. As unwanted thoughts jump into your mind, you must order them to disappear and return to your observation mode. It is a good idea before starting this exercise to tell your conscious self that you intend to concentrate now, and not to bother you with any thoughts. Tell yourself to hold all thoughts until you are through with your meditation, and that you will instruct it when you are ready to continue normal thinking. If you can concentrate for 1 minute without another thought coming into your mind, you will have dramatically changed your life. Our mind is used to manufacturing ideas and images for us all of the time, conforming to the internal wish list provided by our ego and other emotions. If we do not take control of our thinking, Our mind will continue to make up all sorts of images while we are trying to concentrate. Learning to concentrate will help us begin to take control of our thinking processes, but we must be careful to be honest with ourselves and not allow our ego to manufacture unwanted thoughts and images. Continued observation. Continue your observation until a deep feeling of well-being and relaxation is obtained. Allow yourself some time to benefit from the enjoyable state of mind. Relish the moment and become familiar with the location in your mind that has produced this moment, for you will want to return here often. The most important objective during this exercise is to learn to concentrate on any one object for a period of time and keep out unwanted thoughts. Just this simple exercise can begin to restore power to your thinking. By developing the power to concentrate on a single object in meditation, you are learning how to control your thinking, and you can apply this to normal life by being more productive and less influenced by the outside environment. Continue this exercise daily until you can concentrate on a single object without any unwanted thoughts for 1 minute. This may not seem like much, but most people will find it harder than they expect it to be. Summary of exercise. This is a very simple exercise that you can practice any time of day, wherever you are. It's very good to use in a tense or stressful situation to help calm yourself down. I would suggest that you practice the exercise every day before you have lunch. This will serve to compose you from the hectic thoughts of your workday, making your lunch more enjoyable. It also allows you to work the concepts of relaxation, concentration, and thought control into your everyday life. The uses of meditation. Through continued use of meditation, we can learn to control our conscious mind by pausing during the flashing process of thought formation, and allowing our spiritual self to give us advice. We can also learn to program our subconscious to perform work for us while we sleep, for example, in order to lose weight or stop smoking. Emotions that are causing us problems in life can be reprogrammed by creating new experiences that come to happier conclusions. All levels of our mind can be controlled and addressed through meditation. It is this simple exercise that puts us on the road to controlling the communication of all levels of U or mind. Turning off the force of your material thoughts allows the force of your spirit to come forward. Meditation is also the first step towards controlling our material mind and letting the power of our spirit come forward. The ability to call forth our spiritual self and make use of our spiritual powers rests in the ability to turn off our material mind and allow our spiritual self to come through. Our spiritual self is always there, listening to all that we do, and never sleeps. Most of us never consider that we can call forward our spirit to offer an opinion, to give advice, or to teach us something about ourselves and our previous existences. And seldom does anyone ever consider using their spiritual self to contact other life forms. However, all of these things are possible through the continued development of meditation. Pausing as the Pleiadians listen to our thoughts and analyze how we think, it has become apparent to them that we need to learn some simple techniques of controlling our thinking that can be used in everyday life. One of these simple techniques is called the pause. Most of the problems in the world are not caused by disease or wars, but by our thoughts. How often have we spoken too quickly and said something that we regret, only to ruin a deal or a friendship? When we feel depressed or angry, it is our thoughts that control us. If we could learn to pause as our thoughts are being formed or as our emotions are taking control of us, we could be in control of how we feel. Training ourselves to pause before we speak, to consider just for that one quick moment what we are about to say, can save a lot of misery in the world. The pause can be exercised as our minds are flashing between the conscious and the subconscious and adding feelings from the psyche. As thoughts are formed very quickly, we must train ourselves to interact in this process by pausing, either as the thought is being formed or before we speak. As an example, let's say that your boss has just called you into his office about your work. You're in a great mood as you enter his office, and suddenly he begins to call you a boneheaded, good-for-nothing employee who had better shape up or look for another job. Your immediate reaction is to defend yourself, and you feel your body tighten up as you start to react. At this point, you have many choices to make. You could allow his outburst to get you mad and yell back. This would probably get you fired and put you in a foul mood as well. A more controlled response would be to simply let him yell at you until he calms down, say nothing, and keep your job. You may also consider how to say something to calm him down and change his mind about you. There are many options. Just as you are about to speak, pause, and consider what you are about to do. Pause, and let your spiritual self come forward and make a suggestion. Pause, and calm your body with a deep breath before doing anything. If you allow yourself to pause, your spiritual self will send you ideas or hunches that are always of a more gentle and calm nature. Since the spirit cannot be sick, it does not contain any negative thoughts or feelings. It can be relied upon to guide you and give you advice from a more balanced position. How many times have you been trying to think of what to say and the first thing that popped into your mind was the right thing? That is your spiritual self trying to help out. Learn to acknowledge this first little hunch, and consider it more carefully before pushing on and ignoring it. The pause can be very helpful in controlling your conscious mind and your state of balance. If you find yourself deeply depressed, you can pause, explain to yourself that you are allowing an emotion from your psyche to influence your state of mind, and replace the emotion with another image that makes you feel better. By doing this, you have changed how you feel just by pausing and taking part in the thought process. It is our thinking, more than anything else, that keeps the Pleiadians from wanting to have open contact with us. Our thoughts are too often plagued with misery, negativity, or feelings that are very uncomfortable for them to be around. It will not be possible for Earth to have open commerce with the planets of the Pleiades until we learn to think in a more controlled manner. The meditative immersion using colors. While the breathing exercise is good and helps you relax and build concentration, you will want to develop beyond this into a deep meditation, where more things are possible. To achieve this, you can use a method other than turning your observation toward your breath in your nostrils. This method of immersion is now directed toward the eyes in such a way as to concentrate on colors which will appear as the immersion into meditation progresses. There are many methods using colors as a guideline to the depth of immersion into meditation. The members of the FIGU in Switzerland use the following colors, as do many other people. You begin the meditation/concentration with a matter-of-fact attitude. This means that your knowledge of the existence of the colors is present, but you do not think about them directly. It is enough to know that they exist without having to manufacture them first, so they can very simply be observed. As the meditative immersion continues, the colors will systematically come to your eyes as the depth of the immersion continues. The purpose of the colors is to help you understand the depth of your meditative immersion and the possibilities that you are capable of at any level of immersion. The standard colors of meditative immersion used by most people are blue, green, yellow, and red. Blue represents the color of the presence, the life force, and your existence. This will be the first color to present itself and lets you know the immersion has begun. Once the color blue begins to appear, allow to it to occur 3 times. This will let you know it is time to concentrate on your secondary goal determination, the view into the past or future. Green, as the immersion continues and becomes deeper into the spirit, the color green will appear. This represents to you that you are changing from conscious thinking to the subconscious. It can also mean that you are beginning to move in time, either from the present to the past, or the future. Allow the color green to also occur 3 times. Followed by a deep, inward concentration. Yellow represents the color of the concluded change from the conscious to the unconscious, as well as the concluded change from the present to the past or future. Depending on the individual, it may take several months or years to reach this level, for it requires very good concentration skills. Allow the presence of yellow to occur 3 times, with a deep concentration to follow. Red represents the color of penetration into the unconscious, or penetration into the past or future. It is also the signal that the meditative immersion has been attained and now the spiritual subconscious starts to work on its own in reference to the secondary goal determination, which in this case would be time travel into the future or the past. Before starting this meditation, concentrate your thoughts on what you want to accomplish in your meditation. Your first goal is to create TE meditative immersion. Your second goal might be to move in time to see the past or future. The secondary goal must be decided before starting the meditation. Once you have your goals in mind, follow these steps: get into a comfortable position, either sitting or lying down, and loosen up the entire body. Close your eyes and deeply breathe in and out 3 times. With your eyes closed, direct your attention to the back of your eyelids and observe the light. Continue the concentration until the color blue presents itself. Once the immersion is complete and a good concentration is obtained, the color red will slowly vanish and become a veil of mist, causing the occurrence of vague and, at first, incoherent forms of dream images in the waking state that have not been created by you. They must appear without being called or created by you. These waking state, dreamlike images can be distinguished from the normal daydream by their extreme clarity and distinct qualities. They remain extremely constant and do not fade away or disappear like sleeping images do, but remain very vivid. If you are performing the meditation correctly, the images will not display any power of suggestion or try to influence you as a sleeping dream might. At first they will seem hard to understand, but will gradually become logical and understandable, and hopefully begin to make sense. These images always display events in their natural order, instead of jumping around like normal dreams. In most cases, these images are hard to understand and will take many hours of time to understand them. This is done after your return from the meditation immersion. The spirit will send impulses from the subconscious to help bring the image to a conclusion. Our normal world makes this very difficult, for there are billions of people thinking on the planet, making it almost impossible to meditate to any great depth or investigate new images. If you are serious and wish to continue your meditation beyond this level, it will be necessary to construct a pyramid capable of shielding your mind from the thoughts of the world and all outside influences. If you wish to build a personal pyramid, make it about 6 feet high and use the same relative specifications as the Great Pyramid in Egypt. Another extremely important factor when producing waking state dreams is that you must be totally honest with yourself at this stage, and not create these images from your ego. Any thoughts you may have that create these images will be from your own material self and are usually caused directly by your own emotional problems, such as wanting to be popular or revered by others as a great medium, etc. Do not proceed any farther unless you can be honest with yourself. You are in no danger if you allow the images to come from your spiritual self. Return from the meditative immersion. Returning from the meditative immersion is very simple and requires nothing more than a simple thought to initiate the return to the material consciousness. You do not need to be concerned about not being able to return from the immersion, there is never any danger of that. To return, you simply reverse the process of colors that have been used. If you have used the colors of blue, green, yellow, and red as the meditative immersion colors, they will also be used as the colors to return with. Always use the same colors in reverse mode so that your mind understands what you are doing. Simply envision the color red first, it is only necessary to cause the color to occur once at each level. Then replace the color with yellow, then with green, and then with blue. As you envision the colors, it serves as a signal to your mind that you are returning, and you will gradually come out of your immersion and return to the normal, thinking and conscious state. Once the color blue appears, your material consciousness is automatically restored, and you will begin to think in a normal fashion. All of your senses hearing, seeing, touching, smell, and taste will immediately become aware of your environment as you return to the present physical life. It's not uncommon to take a few minutes to become fully oriented, and it is normal to feel a little sleepy, like you are floating on air. Summary of the meditation immersion. The meditation immersion is a very powerful tool that allows the individual full access to control over his thinking, as well as to the powers of the spiritual realm. The method described here is a simple guideline for the individual to follow and experiment with on his own. It can take years to obtain the ability to use the spiritual powers of telepathy, telekinesis, or time travel. The time will vary from person to person, but you can expect to invest many hours in order to see good results. The degree of results depends on the ability to concentrate and develop clarity of vision that allows you to see objects as they really are. Combining the meditation practice with modern techniques using sound waves can dramatically improve your results. Further explanations of certain meditative techniques should be mentioned here to help with your progress and quality of results. Read those ideas carefully and monitor your progress with honesty in order to develop good habits of meditation. The power of observation. The ability to observe objects and see them as they really are is very important in meditation. Objects may be people, thoughts, ideas, visions, or whatever the object of the meditation is. In our normal thinking, we see these objects with our material senses and transfer that image to our subconscious where we receive impulses related to it. After flashing on our memories, attitudes, feelings, and emotions, we may no longer be sensing the object as it really is, but as we perceive it to be. A typical example may be viewing a beautiful sunset at the beach. When the sunset is first observed by our vision, it will flash through our consciousness, and we will immediately feel the impact of all of the stored up memories and feelings that we have about sunsets. Within an instant, thousands of memories about the sun, water, sky, and other wonderful moments come together and we get a nice, warm feeling about the sunset. After all, who doesn't enjoy watching a beautiful sunset over the ocean? Because we have so many stored up memories and feelings about sunsets, we overlook seeing the details that are really there. Instead, the object, the sunset, is taken as a whole, and we rely on our stored up memories to form the observation. This is common throughout life as we call upon our memories and feelings to observe things around us. In meditation, we want to set aside all preconceived memories, feelings, and emotions and observe things from the very beginning as they really are. We want to purely observe the object as a receiver, without influencing the object through our own form of will and without exerting any influence or evaluation on the object. If we are going to meditate on a sunset, we want to set aside all of our memories, feelings, and preconceived notions of what a sunset is and discover it all over again by purely observing it in the meditation. This would be accomplished by entering the meditation/concentration and not allowing any unwanted thoughts or preconceived ideas of what a sunset is to enter our minds. We would concentrate on the image of the sunset and observe it, just as we observed our breath in the breathing exercise. We fix our observation on the sunset and become the observer. As our concentration continues, we will begin to receive impulses from the sunset. Very slowly, the sunset will present itself to us. First, we will become aware of the color of the sun, then, its shape. Very slowly, our observation of the sunset will continue to fill in the smallest and most minute details of all that we are concentrating on. We will become aware of all of the colors around the sun, the water below, and the sky around it. As our concentration continues, our spirit will add the feelings of creation, and the sunset will take on a completely new meaning to us. Acting as a receiver, we will have allowed the sunset to present itself, or speak to us, causing a sensation of spiritual bonding and love that we never thought possible. Complete relaxation and feeling a harmony with nature and creation will flow into our meditation. By letting go of our normal thinking processes, we will have allowed the power of our spirit to come through. Clarity of vision and reflection. Once our abilities of concentration and pure observation lead us into meaningful meditation, we will begin to receive visions and images from different times. When we return from the immersion and begin to reflect on what we have seen and encountered, it is important that we do not allow our material memories and emotions to distort or taint what we have seen. Just as clarity of observation is important in building a truthful concentration, we must also be able to reflect clearly on what we have seen. It is important to remain in a balanced and neutral state of mind while we reflect on what we have seen so that we can learn from it. Time goes by quickly. When you are meditating, time can pass by very quickly. It is not uncommon to discover that 15 or even 30 minutes in meditation can seem like just a couple of minutes. Because of this, it is a good idea to have someone watch the clock, so you can be brought out of the meditation at a definite time. The reason for this is that once you are in a deep meditation/concentration, you lose control of time and have no idea how long you have been there. Your spirit is connected to the timeless and is not used to a watch or timepiece. It is only your material senses that have a sense of time. If you are meditating alone, you might want to set a clock radio or music player of some type to start playing after 30 minutes. This should be very quiet so as to not shock you. Don't worry if you are meditating in bed before falling asleep because the meditation will find its end after you fall asleep. Neutral thinking. In your normal, daily thinking process, you should learn to think neutrally. I call this being in balance. The idea of neutral thinking is to develop a discipline of thinking that prevents us from having negative or positive thoughts in any form. This is accomplished in part by the pause, which intervenes during the flashing as our thoughts are made. As we become more in control of our thinking, it is much easier to keep out unwanted negative and positive thoughts that throw us out of balance. Of course, in normal life we all have thoughts that are varying degrees of negative and positive. It's just part of our normal learning process. Developing the concept of neutral thinking gives us control over our thinking and allows us to be more neutral, or balanced, when we need to be. This process also gives us more control over our negative and positive thoughts, so they do not have as much control over us. It is also desirable to keep negative and positive thoughts out of our concentration and only allow purely neutral thoughts to be applied. It is our negative thinking that makes open, public contact with the Pleiadians impossible. We have over 5 billion people on Earth who are thinking with no control. They are creating energies uncomfortable to the Pleiadians and harmful to ourselves and nature. If we could teach the whole world to think in a more balanced way and to keep out the more exaggerated negative and positive thoughts, most of our differences would vanish overnight. The boomerang. One of the problems in dealing with our own thoughts is that it is sometimes hard to discover what constitutes a negative or positive thought. We are not used to analyzing our thinking and saying, "Oops, there goes a negative thought," or "Now I'm thinking positively." Most of us are not even aware of our thinking and haven't given much thought to what kinds of thoughts we are creating. We are comfortable that our thoughts are not heard by anyone else, so we don't have to be concerned about what we think. Besides, who is to decide if a thought is negative or positive? If we wanted to analyze our thoughts in order to clean up our thinking and learn something about ourselves, there is a logical way we can monitor our thoughts and see if they are positive or negative, and know what kind of effect they are having on the universe. It's called the boomerang. When a thought is created inside of your head, it does not stay there. Even though we are not consciously aware of it, our thoughts leave our physical body and go out into the universe. Thoughts are much faster than the speed of light and can penetrate deep into the cosmos instantly. Your thinking blends in with billions of other thoughts and takes its part in the scheme of things. Most importantly, just like a boomerang, our thoughts reach a certain distance and then turn around and come back to us. The boomerang effect is the process of sending back the thought you sent out, but in a slightly changed form. There are two parts to a thought. There is the thought itself, and then there is the energy that hurls the thought out into the universe. When your thought speeds out into the universe, it will eventually come to the end of its travels, and like a boomerang, it will turn around and head back to where it came from. Another interesting part of this process is that the thought will become polarized by the energy of the universe and return in a slightly different form. The thought itself will not change and will return in the same form as when it left, but the energy that hurled it out into the cosmos will return it in the opposite polarity to when it left. If we pay attention to this process, we will be able to learn for ourselves the effect our thoughts are really having. You see, we may think we are thinking very positively, but perhaps we are not. Ego can get in the way and distort our thinking. By using the process of the boomerang as a means of analyzing our thinking, we can really learn what is going on in our minds. This, of course, requires a certain honesty with ourselves, as we might not always like the result. Let's see how this works. Even though it is of importance to us, the actual thought itself is of little relevance to the universe. It is the charge of the hurling energy that has an effect throughout the universe. If you are thinking about your relationship and how much you care about this person, the thought is very important to you, and you would probably consider it a positive thought. Let us say the thought is about how anxiously you are looking forward to seeing your lover on Saturday night. You're dwelling on this idea and envisioning going to dinner and spending time with each other. To you, this is a very positive and happy thought. As you think these thoughts, they speed out into the cosmos. Your vision of having dinner together, the thought you created, is intact. As you create this thought in your mind, a small form of energy that will hurl this idea out into the universe is also formed. This hurling energy has an electrical charge created by you. It may be negative or positive, depending on the meaning of your thinking. As the thought reaches the end of its travels out into the cosmos, it slows down and begins to depolarize. The thought of having dinner stays the same, but the hurling energy depolarizes and switches poles. If the hurling energy had been negative, it would now be positive and vice versa. The thought and its hurling energy now are speeding back towards you. The thought is still the same, but the hurling energy is now in its opposite form. The distance the thought has traveled is dependent on the power of your thought and the force of your spirit. It may return to you quickly within a few minutes, or sometimes it may take up to 3 days to return. Consider also that you may continue thinking this thought for some time and send it out millions of times, each one returning at different times. The power of the returning hurling energy is equal to the power of the sending hurling energy. If you have sent out a thought that was hurled by very large amounts of negative energy, you will receive one back with very large amounts of positive energy. As the thought returns, your mind acts as a radio receiver and picks it up. It has returned and entered your mind for consideration. This is an automatic process that happens continually in your mind. This forces you to once again think the same thought, but it has returned encompassed with a hurling energy of different force. What left your mind as a positive and happy thought will return with a negative charge, causing you to think the same thought of having dinner with your lover, but you will feel the effects of the negative hurling energy that came with it. Your mind will immediately consider the upcoming event of having dinner with a slightly different viewpoint this time and send the thought out again. This happens millions of times, causing us to consider something from many different views. Our spiritual selves watch this process and are not affected by it, but our material minds can become confused, angry, depressed, happy, sad, or can even cause sickness in the body as a result. If we send out thoughts intentionally and watch for their return, we can learn how we are really thinking, and work out the answers to our problems. For instance, we may have ulterior motives for having dinner with someone and not be consciously aware of it. The boomerang effect will draw our attention to the true meaning of our thinking and make us face up to the idea of what we are really up to. Even though others don't hear our thoughts, we must face up to them ourselves. You cannot lie to yourself or fool your spirit. In the end, you must learn to be honest with yourself. If you do not, you will make yourself sick. The boomerang process will help us learn more about ourselves. We are working toward a time of development where the strength of the positive and the negative are equal. This is balance. Once you can form a thought from a completely balanced viewpoint, it will return the same way. A balanced thought is one that does not contain a negative or positive hurling charge. It is neutral and returns the same as when it left. The feeling of a returning thought that is in balance can be felt by your spirit, just as a negative or positive one can. You will be able to feel it and learn to recognize the neutral polarity. There is a feeling of contentment that comes over you when you know you are thinking logically. It is a form of spiritual bonding that lets you know that you are in alignment with the universe. We must have positive and negative thoughts in order to learn and grow. It is a natural process of growth. If we only created positive thoughts, we could not develop. The boomerang is a way of monitoring ourselves and learning to face the truth about our thinking. Here we discover that our material thoughts are filled with many devious spikes put there by inflated egos and emotional problems. Just the stress of living in our everyday world pushes us to defend ourselves with rather creative thinking. Our spirits cannot become sick or create illogical thoughts and are not affected by ego and emotions. Learning to think in a more balanced way through the use of our spirits is the path to higher consciousness. Using the boomerang and being honest and open with ourselves is a sign of clear thinking, intelligence, and growth. This is the end of part 13. For more information about the Pleiadian Mission, please visit thepleiadianmission.com. Again, please visit thepleiadianmission.com. Also subscribe and share this video. Let the whole world know the truth. Thank you for listening. Remember that knowledge is power. Please, don't be left in the dark. Please continue to part 14 in the next video.